Hey guys, it's Professor Dave. Let's talk about carbocation rearrangement.
He knows a lot about the science stuff, Professor Dave explains.
So to take a look at carbocation rearrangement, let's revisit some old reactions. We're going to take a look at the E1 and the SN1 reactions, but this time they're going to be acid catalyzed. Remember that the E1 and SN1 reactions have carbocation intermediates. So let's take a look here. We have this secondary alcohol here, and if we treat with strong acid, that will pick up this proton like this. Now we have basically water, a water molecule, and that is going to be a good leaving group. Remember that something is a good leaving group if it's going to be stable once it has left. Water is very stable, so that's a great leaving group. So that leaves us with this secondary carbocation. Now, here's the thing. We remember that due to hyperconjugation, a more substituted carbocation is a more stable one. And if a substrate is going to be able to rearrange so as to generate a more stable carbocation, it will do so. And there's two ways that it can do this. So let's say we have a secondary carbocation next to either a tertiary or quaternary carbon. So here's our tertiary carbon next door. So in this case, we can have something called a hydride shift. Now, a hydride shift is H minus. So typically we're used to, if we're seeing hydrogen as an ion, seeing it as H plus, a proton. But we can also have H minus. This is basically a hydrogen nucleus with a pair of electrons. So that's H minus. And a hydride shift means that this hydrogen atom with both of the electrons in this bond can basically shift over. So here's that hydrogen. So that's literally just going to hop from one carbon to the other. And the reason it will do this is because in doing so, it will neutralize the carbocation over here, but generate a new one on the tertiary carbon. So this is a more stable carbocation intermediate. So basically, we also want to take a look at the transition state here, where the hydrogen atom is weakly interacting with both of these carbons. So it's almost as though we have a partial plus, or almost like half of a positive charge on each of those carbons as it is shifted from one right over to the next one. So typically this, we're looking at this as being able to happen from between adjacent carbons. So if we have a secondary carbon that's very far away from a secondary carbocation that's rather far away from a tertiary or quaternary carbon, this probably isn't going to happen. But because there is a tertiary carbon next door, this hydride is able to migrate one carbon over. So now we have that tertiary carbocation, and let's say we're just going to interact with a water molecule, a molecule of solvent. Now this oxygen can either go ahead and coordinate to the carbocation, giving us a racemic mixture of SN1 products, or it can eliminate, grab a proton there, or grab the proton that shifted, and give us one of these two different E1 products. In this case, because water is pretty small, we're probably going to expect the Zaitsev product to dominate over the Hoffman. So that's the hydride shift. Now we can also have a methanide shift. A methanide is CH3-. So it's a methyl group with formal negative charge. So we can just go back up here and replace all of these hydrogens. Now let's pretend this is a methyl group here. So this is no longer hydrogen. That's just a regular methyl group. So the rest is the same. So here's our CH3, and then if we look at the transition state, we're seeing the same thing happening, whereas now it's simply that that carbon atom is weakly bound to each of these carbons in the transition state. So an entire methyl group, or we should say a methanide group, is shifting from this carbon to satisfy that secondary carbocation, and in doing so, leaving a tertiary carbocation, which again is more stable, and that's the driving force behind this rearrangement. It's always thermodynamics. Everything is trying to get to the lowest energy possible. So if it can shift and become more comfortable, it will do so. And then once again, we can just add methyl groups all around to represent that methyl group that shifted. And once again, probably Zaitsev will dominate here. So just to reiterate, the take home is that when you have a secondary carbocation adjacent to either a tertiary or now a quaternary carbon, If that can rearrange, it will do so by either doing a hydride or a methanide shift. Thanks for watching, guys. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. And as always, feel free to email me with questions, professordaveexplains@gmail.com.